Today, it's just me and the ladies.
Well, I said, welcome to a small business marketing show, where successful small business owners share their souls to take your marketing straight to the lead. Now, here's your host, Mr. Timbo Reed.
Welcome back, listeners, to another episode of Australia's number one marketing show. I'm your host, Timbo Reed, but you, so much more importantly, are a motivated business owner ready to crank out some great marketing. And that is exactly what we do around here. We give you the tools, the insights, the inspiration to build that beautiful business of yours into the empire it deserves to be. And that is made possible by two very loving companies. One is NetRegistry, who get your online marketing sorted. You can check out some exclusive listener offers over at netregistry.com.au/Timbo. And 99 Designs, the world's largest graphic design marketplace, where you're guaranteed to get a design you will love. You get a free $99 upgrade over at 99designs.com/Timbo. Hey, big show. Yeah, big show. Different show today. Got a bit of a trip down memory lane as I revisit four fireside chats I've had over the past few years with some amazing business women. Got a motivational quote about the payoff you get for going that extra mile. Got some very interesting news about next episode's guest. And as per usual, I would have to say, and I hope you agree, that there is marketing G-O-L-D dripping from the ceiling over here at Small Business Big Marketing's HQ. So let's get stuck right in.
Do you need a speaker for your next conference? Recommend Timbo to your event organiser. Or better still, book him. Tim Reed. That's reid.com.au.
I reckon it's time for a quick check-in. How are you? How are you? How's your business? Is it all coming together? Are you ticking some boxes, getting stuff done? My last guest today talks about getting stuff done big time. She's brutal about it. Wait for that. But I hope you've had a great week. I've had a pretty good week. Sort of up and down. You're allowed to share downs as much as ups. I think it's a good thing. Bit of venting, bit of kind of like, you know, we're all in this together. Sold our house this week. I'm a bit sad. Can you hear it in my voice? Yeah, sort of like family voted and I lost, so we're moving up to town. That's okay. I've also taken the lease on a beach house where I'm going to be sort of going down and sort of like a work retreat. We're also going to have a big family holiday over Christmas, which we're no longer going to do. We're going to spend it down the beach, which is kind of nice. So that's kind of, that balances out selling the family home, I suppose. Hey, spoke at a really good conference, I guess, on Friday in Sydney, a jewellers conference, top 100 performing jewellers for a particular buying group. And, you know, I got the most beautiful thank you at the end of my keynote, a really heartfelt thank you in front of the whole audience by the MC, who was the organiser. And I'm not saying that out of ego. I'm saying it because it just felt so good. And if there's someone you would really love to thank, I encourage you to do it, because it will put a smile on their dial, a skip in their step. And don't put it off, because I've got to tell you what this fellow said to the audience after I walked off stage. I tell you what, I didn't need Qantas to fly me home. I could have flown home myself. So it's just a lovely reminder. 99 Designs signed on for another quarter, another 3 months, taking us through till the end of the year, which I'm really excited about. Clearly, being associated with the show is working for them, and that excites me. So I hope you're using them. A little bit more on them later. And working on a new sponsor. There has been a space available in the new Friday episode alongside the guys at Key Person of Influence, and I reckon I've locked that away. I'll reveal more, hopefully, next episode. All in all, it's been a pretty good. Oh, the other thing too, that trip I'm taking to the Philippines, there's about 12 listeners going, September 21 with David Warren, the Rock and the Boat tour, where we're going to investigate what it means to outsource your marketing requirements and other business requirements into the Philippines, a three-day tour. So that's good. 12 listeners. I'm looking forward to that. And I know David's been smashed by a whole lot of other listeners in terms of requesting his outsourcing services. If you want to check his check what he's doing with these tours out, because they happen every month, head over to rockingtheboattours.com. All in all, an interesting week. I hope yours has been a ripper.
Join the Small Business Big Marketing community and have your marketing questions answered by other motivated business owners, including Timbo, over at crankmymarketing.com.
Righto, well, let's get stuck into the meat and potatoes of this week's episode. As I said, not the normal episode. You and I are taking a trip down memory lane and revisiting some old episodes. And I have gone and pulled out four fireside chats I've had with amazing businesswomen over the past few years. You know, one thing I've always been very conscious of is that there's certainly been a skew towards male guests. If you haven't noticed it, I am bringing that to your attention. And I do love talking to the ladies. There's a different dynamic, and often they are more open and transparent. Maybe that's not the word, but certainly open in the way they talk about being in business and going about doing the business. So I have pulled out four. The first one is Mia Friedman. Now, Mia, past editor of Cosmopolitan, quite an amazing lady, founder and editorial director of Australia's biggest women's blogging website called Mamma Mia, got an audience of like 650,000 unique users a month. And since being on this show, Mia has started not a podcast, but a podcast network. So maybe I've had some influence on that. I don't know. Maybe I'll never know. Now, an important aspect of effective marketing is single-minded communication. You know, one message communicated well as opposed to five messages communicated poorly. So I picked things up where I asked Mia if the single-mindedness of the Mamma Mia blog was the fact that it communicated only to women.
And it was for a long time, because at first it was just me, and my husband would say, you know, what's your elevator pitch? What's Mamma Mia about? What's the tagline? And, you know, as a way to sort of challenge me. And I couldn't answer him. And for a long time, I sort of mistakenly, and he mistakenly assumed that that was its weakness, that you couldn't say what it was about in 140 characters. But I came to realize and explain to him and understand myself that was actually its strength, because the way women talk is they talk about everything. So they will go from talking about gun control to talking about a celebrity who's just got divorced, to talking about, you know, their pelvic floor after they have a baby, to talking about feminism, to talking about climate change. And that will probably be in the first 5 minutes, and it doesn't matter whether they know each other or not. Mm-hmm. And that's very, very different to the way men communicate, you know, and it's also was at the time and is still very different to the majority of websites out there that are directed at women, because you have parenting sites, you have fashion sites, you have news sites, which the news sites tend to be very male dominated and, you know, absolute shit fights in terms of the level of commentary. But I know, as someone who is a parent and someone who's interested in fashion, interested in news, none of those, you know, all of those sites are too specialist for me.
Now, Mia, you have spoken a lot about targeting women, marketing to women, and building communities of women. And I know there's a lot of listeners who would love some insights into ways of marketing to women, because it's different to blokes.
Yeah, it is different to blokes. It's really interesting. It's something that I've had to sort of step out of myself and try to put it into words, because a lot of what we do is kind of just instinctive. But the most important thing is authenticity. And that was the reason that I was really moving away from magazines, because I just felt that they weren't authentic. Magazines and lots of forms of media don't communicate with women in authentic ways. And what Mamma Mia does is always, and the best thing when you're trying to communicate with women is to try to find an emotional entry point into something. And so I'll give you an example. So there's an ad at the moment for a dishwashing tablet. A new dishwashing tablet, finished dishwashing tablet. And they're running an ad with a blogger from Kidspot, which is a parenting website. Mm-hmm. And it's got her in her kitchen standing in front of her dishwasher going, you know, I've been using these Finish dishwashing tablets and they are just so amazing. And my dishes have never been so shiny. And look at the shine. And I just can't believe it. And I'm going to tell all my friends about it and they won't even believe how shiny my dishes are.
Is this an ad from 1953?
That's exactly right. So look at it. And Finish approached us a little while ago about this new dishwashing thing. And so what we don't just run display advertising, although we do. Something that we do that's incredibly popular is that we offer these social media packages, which is about integrating content and engaging. You know, you can't just flash an ad at a woman and expect her to engage with it. You've got to embed it in a conversation. So, you know, they came to us and they said, we've got this new dishwashing thing and it's got this new ingredient and it's going to do this. And we went, okay, well, that's all very interesting for you, but there's no emotional entry point into having shiny dishes. Like, I don't know anyone who, if any friend of mine tried to tell me about her shiny dish, I'd call an ambulance.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, that ain't no friend of mine.
So what we said is, okay, let's talk about dishwashers. What's the emotional entry point into dishwashers? And we worked out it's in every household, there is someone who is the dishwashing police. There's someone who knows the perfect way to stack a dishwasher.
Yep. That's me, by the way. So you're ringing my bell here.
So immediately when I tell that story, everyone will go, oh, yeah, that's me, or oh, that's my flatmate, or that's my husband. And what it does is that it embeds this information about this new dishwashing thing in conversations about who's the dishwashing police in your house. And suddenly you have all these comments about when people are engaged rather than just passively watching someone talk about their shiny dishes and some new ingredient. I mean, who cares about a new ingredient in a dishwashing tablet? It's how is this relevant to my life and how is this authentic? And that's what I love about online, in that it enables you to talk directly and authentically to women about anything.
That was Mamma Mia's Mia Friedman. You can hit Mia up on Twitter. Tell her you heard her on the show at Mia Friedman. Support for this show comes from 99 Designs, where dozens of designers compete to deliver a fast, affordable design you'll love. Speaking of love, their big cheese, Patrick Llewellyn, recently compared 99 Designs to a dating site.
We really think of contests almost like the dating paradigm. You go to a nightclub, it's noisy, there's a lot of people to meet, you get to meet a lot of people, and if you're lucky, you know, at the end of that process, you might meet someone, right? And then you go on and have dates. And so a contest is kind of like that paradigm. You put up your proposal, lots of designers submit their ideas, and then you start to whittle down to a few of the ones that really resonate with you. And then ultimately, you pick one of them. And once you've picked that one designer, the chances of you going on to work with that designer to get other things designed is actually very high.
99 Designs, where love is in the air. For a free $99 upgrade on your first design, visit 99designs.com/Timbo.
Get on Timbo's mailing list over at smallbusinessbigmarketing.com.
Okay, the next amazing businesswoman that's appeared on the show is Naomi Simpson. Now, Naomi is the founder of Red Balloon, which is an amazing online experience retailer. She is also one of the sharks on the Australian version of Shark Tank. Naomi's the one in that big red dress every week. I got Naomi on the show because I went on this media junket a few years ago for Microsoft. About 3 years ago, they invited a few influential bloggers and podcasters down to Tassie for the V8 Supercars to launch Office 360. Naomi's publicity manager was there as well, and that's how this interview came about. Now, Naomi worked at Apple and Ansett prior to starting Red Balloon. So I picked this fireside chat up where I ask Naomi if she ever thought it would be easier to head back to that cushy corporate existence.
It never occurred to me to give up, never to me. So I was working from home, keeping my overheads low, passionate about what I was doing. Everybody said, oh, that's such a good idea, but they weren't actually buying. So it never occurred to me to give up. Like, I don't know. I just knew one day it would be okay. It would all turn out in the end, as they say, and it wasn't the end yet, so it would be okay.
Isn't that incredible? That whole, so many business owners would be listening to what you just said of it. I know I've got a good idea. I know my service or my product is good. Everyone says it is, but they're not buying. That is one of the most frustrating aspects of running a business.
Oh, absolutely. Unbelievably frustrating. So, But also, you know, the thing is to keep asking the question, you know, what have I learned? What do I need to change? What do I need to grow? The business is nothing like what it was, you know, 12 or 13 years ago when I started it. It's completely different. In fact, even the business model is different than it once was. So, you know, our point is to keep listening and responding and using metrics particularly to look for trends, because you can't respond to every customer. If you've got, you know, 500,000 customers now we have a year, well, they've all got an opinion. And many have given their opinions. Well, we can't please all of them. You know, one says they want it blue and the other says they want it yellow. Well, what do you do? You know,
so okay. So at what point do you go, oh, hang on, enough have said that yellow seems to be the better option. Is there a number? Is it a gut feeling? How do you know?
Well, that's when we now look at the technologies available for us as listening tools and also in terms of analytical tools. I think the most important thing for anybody who does take the time to put pen to paper is that we acknowledge that they have an opinion and it's really appreciated. And thank you for letting us know. But it's not physically possible to please everybody.
No, that's for sure. So there wasn't a point where you thought this is too hard. You learned along the way, things changed, business models changed, the way you went about it changed, but you just kept going. You knew you were on a good thing. What about then the moment when you thought, oh, hang on, this is going to be pretty big?
Yeah, I don't know if I overthought that really. Like sometimes you're so busy in the business, you're not looking out to the future. Only really since I've become a director rather than, you know, there's a CEO, Christy Kennedy now is the CEO of Revalune, and so I work as a director, that I'm far more future-focused and vision-focused. You know, in those early days, it's pretty much hand-to-mouth and you're running very fast, and some days you wonder if you moved ahead at all. And not to say we didn't have some really, really tough times. There's times where, went home in tears and couldn't face another day and all of those sorts of things. And I remember an entrepreneur friend of mine, Tim Pethick, he said, entrepreneurs are like those clown punching bags. You know, we've got big smiles on our face, you punch as hard as you can, and then we just get up again. And I said, but what if I don't want to get up? And he said, oh, there I was thinking you were an entrepreneur. And so, of course, I just get up again.
That was Naomi Simpson from Red Balloon. You can hit Naomi up on Twitter at Naomi Simpson with no P. Okay. Are you enjoying it? You enjoy hearing from these amazing women? Oh, I love it. Next one, Karen Jacobson. This was an interesting one. Karen, professional singer. Like, she's got 5 CDs out. She's sung with Cyndi Lauper. She's sung in front of 80,000 people at Madison Square Gardens. But she's also the voice of Apple's Siri and TomTom Navigation. If you go for the Australian Karen on the TomTom Navigation device, that's Karen. She's also got this business called the GPS Girl, Recalculating Your Life. So she's made something out of being the voice on the TomTom Navigation. I got her on the show because we shared the stage at a conference in LA about 12 months ago and asked if she would appear. I picked things up where I asked Karen about how she overcomes fear.
You know, that's an entire other podcast conversation, because overcoming anxiety has been an absolute challenge and mission for me since I was very little. So I'm now in a really healthy place with it, but it took me decades to be able to not feel just beside myself when I was doing something big.
Oh, wow. You have opened up a can of worms there. There are listeners just kind of screaming down the speaker, go that way, Tim, go that way. Forget everything else you're going to talk to Karen about.
Well, you know what? I was interviewed about something recently and that came up and we talked in depth about it. And I think there's actually a book specifically about that.
It holds fear, anxiety, whatever you want to call it. It holds so many of us back, myself included, at various levels, you know. Just, if you can learn to treat it as a positive. I talk to my kids about it. They got exams coming up. So use it as a positive. You know, I get it. I spoke, you know, gosh, you just mentioned 80,000. I spoke to 300 people 2 nights ago. But, you know, you get it. But it's like, I just remember saying to myself, enjoy this feeling, you know, like enjoy it.
I am. It's interesting we're talking about this because since the time you and I met, which was only a few weeks ago, and now, I am in this phase of just bursting through fear, like old fears, new small fears, big fears. I'm like, it can get out of my way. I'm like, I am not letting these things get in my way anymore. And when you run your own business, when you're an entrepreneur, when you're the person who has to wake up every morning and find a way to pick up the phone, to keep reaching out, even if you're hearing no, which we who are in business here, it is just keeping that mindset of keeping going. Or keep on recalculating, as I like to say. Just keep going. Let it go. Keep going. And that is the practice.
Oh, yeah. It's like, absolutely. And playing with that, having that mindset of, you know what, I'm going to beat it. I'm going to punch through whatever fear is stopping me, moving forward and say, you know what, I'm going to play with it, it works. I also know that there's times and when you can't even find almost the playfulness to say that to yourself because the fear has overcome the idea of going, hey, let's have some fun with this.
Right. Oh, yeah. I've been there too. And that was, you know, one day last week and I, you know, have a mastermind group that I meet with regularly and I was having a good old whinge actually on that call and I was just, you know, just so frustrated with a particular aspect of my business and I was just saying exactly what was happening, exactly how I was feeling. And I apologized because I felt like I was absolutely complaining. But you know what? Out of expressing the frustration that I was feeling, I got off that call and I felt free. And I could, that was a turning point. So I'm always recommending that in a safe environment, in a healthy way, to be able to express when you are frustrated with an aspect of business rather than hold it in because that's another tool to consciously move through it and move forward.
I then went on and asked Karen how she became the voice of Siri and TomTom.
I had moved to New York at the age of 31 and I say that because it wasn't a straight out of university move. It was, you know, I had an established life and business in Brisbane, then moved to Sydney, and I had a lot of really great things happening in my career and in my business. And I just knew, though, that I needed to be here. And I moved over here, which was an extreme experience. A couple of years after I arrived, I had always done voiceovers in my Sydney years as well as singing and other aspects of the entertainment business. And I was asked to audition for a client who was looking for a native Australian female voiceover artist living in the northeast of the United States.
Hello.
And I read that brief and I was like, well, that's me. This is my job. It was one of those few times in my life where I've read a brief and thought, well, it's mine. And I went to the audition. They had me read a number of different prompts for this audition and I got the job. And I found myself recording for almost 50 hours to create a voice system, a text-to-speech voice system that was groundbreaking at the time. This was recorded in the year 2002, and somebody had worked out, a team of engineers had worked out what script I would need to record to capture every combination of syllables possible.
Wow.
So they were creating this master voice system so that afterward you could type in any sentence and my voice would speak it.
Did you know what you were doing it for at that time?
No.
They didn't tell you who the client was?
Well, I was doing this for a third-party company and they said it was going to be used for a variety of things and that's what I knew, but I wasn't clear what exactly, and I certainly did not expect my voice to be in over 100 million GPS units and 240 million smartphones and elevators and cruise ships and all of the amazing places my voice has ended up.
So tell me, okay, how did that happen? So 50 hours you've gone and recorded that for that third-party company that wasn't Apple, obviously, but were, so did they then sell that technology, which included your voice, to Apple, to TomTom, to Otis Elevators. Is that how it happened?
Yeah.
So that one set of 50 hours work is actually the same work that we hear on Tom, Tom and Siri.
That's right.
Crazy.
Isn't it crazy? And just such an unexpected turn in my life and in my career. And I did that job and then I came back to my life here. And well, because I actually went upstate to a studio and spent 3 weeks to complete that job. And then I came back to New York and I continued on with my singing and my songwriting and my music. And I just had no idea. And it was quite a while later that my voice popped up in a GPS unit.
So is this the first time that 50 hours work had then kind of shown itself publicly?
Yes.
And how did it happen?
Well, I was back in Australia over Christmas and I got a voicemail message when I was checking my messages, and a girlfriend of mine left this message and she said, "Karen, my husband and I, we are driving back to New York from Maine after Christmas, and I bought my husband one of those new GPS things and we're playing with it in the car." And then I said, "Hey, put it on the Australian voice." And so we put it on the Australian voice and it's you. You're in the GPS. And I said to my husband, "Oh my God, I bought you Karen Jacobson for Christmas."
That was Siri. I mean, Karen Jacobson. Be sure to hit her up on Twitter. Tell her you heard her on the show at the GPS girl. Support for this show comes from Net Registry. Recently, I was Skyping it up with Verity Ma, their chief marketing officer, when the line deteriorated. She thought it may be because she had loads of browsers open. At which point I'm like, why so many browsers?
Well, because websites appear differently on different browsers. So if I run multiple, then I can get a sense of how our websites are tracking across different browsers and customers' websites.
Net Registry, where attention to detail rules. Visit netregistry.com.au/Timbo for a website that works on, well, all browsers. All right, last but certainly not least, is Michelle Bridges. Now, Michelle, for those of you who don't know, and there's a lot of overseas listeners, Michelle's the most influential personal trainer in Australia. She's also the lead coach on the TV series The Biggest Loser. She's the author of 12 best-selling books, holder of 2 Guinness Book of Records, and creator of the amazing 12-week Body Challenge, which is a fantastic online business. I emceed a conference about a year ago, again, where Michelle was one of the speakers. So I got to know her then. Very accommodating lady, I've got to say. We pick things up where I ask Michelle how she deals with her celebrity.
When I first started, particularly on television, because that's when people really got to know me. Like, I was very well known in the fitness industry, very well known in the fitness industry, but no general public, unless mm-hmm. they came to my classes or came to my gym, knew me. And so when TV started, suddenly everybody was sort of recognizing me, and I felt completely and utterly embarrassed, mortified, especially if I was with friends, like so embarrassed. And because I didn't want to be seen as, in good old Australian terms, as a wanker. Mm-hmm. So if people would come up to me and ask for a photograph, I'd be like, "Oh my God, how embarrassing." Mm. Okay, sure. And anyway, a good dear friend of mine said, "Michelle, I know you, and so I know that this embarrasses you, but you need to take stock because you're coming across as aloof, like you don't care." And I was like, "Are you serious?" And he said to me, "Yeah. So you need to embrace this, otherwise you're going to end up coming across to people like you know, you're above them or mm-hmm. better than that or whatever." And I was like, "Oh my God, okay." So slowly but surely, if someone said to me, "Oh, are you that girl? Are you that girl on that TV show?" Instead of like cringing with embarrassment, I'd be like, "Yeah, I am that girl." And they'd say, "Can we get a photo?" I'm like, "Sure, let's get a photo. Get as many as you like." You know, like, and that's not always easy because, you know, you're trying to do your groceries or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But it meant I let it flow through me rather than fight it. And it's been a little bit easier to accept it that way.
That's really interesting. What a great bit of advice from your friend. Because for someone to tap you on the shoulder and say, hey, you're coming across as aloof versus
Jim. Yeah, I've got some pretty good friends in my life. I've got some pretty good friends. They keep me very well grounded. And they were like, you need to like work this out, Michelle, because it doesn't look good. And I was like, I'm embarrassed. I said, I know that you're embarrassed, but other people don't know that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They don't know you. So I thought, it was good advice.
I want to finish with a lovely acronym that you share from stage, and I'm sure you share it in other places, Michelle. JFDI.
I have a feeling.
Yeah.
I had a feeling that was going to turn up somewhere in this interview.
JFDI. Well, I don't
know. It works for everything. It works for everything. It works for putting your clothes away. It works for getting your car serviced. It works for having to go and talk to your bank manager. It works for getting up off the couch and going and doing some exercise. It just works for everything. It works for everything. JFDI.
And is it really as simple as just f***ing doing it?
Yes.
Is it?
It really is that simple. It's like, this is for all the overthinkers, all the procrastinators, everybody that suffers by analysis, by paralysis. It's just like, get over it. Just get up and do it. Just shut up and do it.
Because I guess as a personal trainer, one of the things that you would get a lot is excuses. So it's just like JFDI, mate.
Yeah, I mean, I use them. We all use them. We've all got plenty of them. Some of us polish those excuses to within an inch of their life, and they actually become truths after a while.
Yeah.
But you end up cutting through all the BS with my beautiful JFDI statement.
Love it. Man, has Team Bridges got a JFDI T-shirt?
We've got the T-shirt. We've got the hat. We've got the bag. We've got a lot.
Love it. That was Michelle Bridges, and yes, you can hit her up on Twitter at Mish, M-I-S-H, Bridges. Tell her you heard her on the show. Some wise old soul once said, if you are willing to do more than you are paid to do, eventually you will be paid to do more than you do.
Join the Small Business Big Marketing community and have your marketing questions answered by other motivated business owners, including Timbo, over at crankmymarketing.com.
That brings us almost to the end of episode 260 of the Small Business Big Marketing Show. Plenty, plenty of marketing gold coming your way. Hey, next episode, I have a chat with a chiropractor that is doing some mind-blowing video marketing. In fact, when I contacted his media manager, yes, he has a media manager, she said he's being hit for interview requests from media outlets around the world. Hey, be sure to use NetRegistry if you need a website or any part of your online marketing sorted. They've got exclusive listener packages over at netregistry.com.au/Timbo. Grab a free $99 design upgrade over at 99designs.com/Timbo. You will not be unimpressed, let me tell you. And if you need a speaker for an upcoming event, then I'm all yours. Check out timreed.com.au. If you want to surround yourself with other motivated business owners, then join the Small Business Big Marketing Forum with a brand spanking new sales page and amazing testimonials over at crankmymarketing.com. Until next week, I'm Timbo Reed. May your marketing be the best marketing. Bye for now.